Are your colors my colors? Hey Crash, today we're going to talk about sight. More specifically, how we're able to see and the role that light plays in this.
Sight really is a double-edged sword sometimes. On the bright side, I get to see my reflection every morning. But then I go to work and I have to look at your ugly mug all day.
See, now it's interesting you mentioned the bright side, because that's our first clue into how we're able to see.
Wow, you just completely deflected my insult. Those stress avoidance classes are really working out for you, huh, Culture? In fact, they're the only thing working out for you, since you never go to the gym. Aren't you jealous of my muscles?
Me being jealous of your muscles would be like Eminem being jealous of Justin Bieber's new haircut. Speaking of intensely bright things, to understand sight, we first have to understand light. Light is a type of electromagnetic radiation which has a wavelength in the visible spectrum. Radiation is essentially formed when an atom's electrons drop down an energy level, or orbital, thus releasing energy. This energy has both electric and magnetic wave components traveling perpendicular to one another, making it electromagnetic radiation. However, this radiation is confusing since it actually has two ways in which it behaves.
I behave in two different ways as well. There's how I act when Culture is being a little bitch, and then there's... Actually, I guess I only behave in one way.
What I meant is that light behaves both as a wave and as a particle. Waves are patterns of energy with amplitude, oscillation, and so on, like the ones I described in the How Loud is Loud video. A particle can be thought of as a small portion of matter. Light was, at first, considered to be a particle by the likes of Isaac Newton. He observed that shadows had crisp edges, and as such, it only made sense for light to be matter. This was despite him also showing that white light could be split into its component colors by using a glass prism. But we'll come back to colors later. There were a few physicists who entered evidence into the debate of particle versus wave, but the case drew on.
Sounds like a courtroom drama. You're out of order! You're out of order!
The whole trial is out of order, goddammit!
Actually, that sounds more like a case about entropy. Just a little joke for the physics kids out there. Anyway, the next predominant theory came from Scottish physicist James Clerk Maxwell, who pretty much predicted and defined light as an electromagnetic wave in 1864. His four equations of electromagnetism, which I won't go into today, are the cornerstones of the field and link electrical fields to magnetic fields. It wasn't until the end of the 19th century that Albert Einstein revived the light as a particle movement, albeit with a very important caveat. Einstein believed that the quanta, or smallest particle, of light was the photon. However, it was the flow of these photons that gave light its wave-like properties. To examine this further, let's think about two key properties of light, its intensity and its energy.
Ugh, I didn't realize this was going to be a physics episode. This is worse than when Family Guy does an episode about Meg.
Jeez, where'd you pull that reference from? The mid-2000s? Just stick with me here.
I liked the part when Peter forgot how to sit down. That was a good episode.
Anyway, Einstein's light quantum theory defined the intensity of light as being proportional to the amount of photons in a wave. The actual energy of the wave, however, was equal to its oscillation frequency times Planck's constant. The oscillation frequency is how often a photon completes a full cycle of a wave, up and down, and Planck's constant is a factor connecting these two variables. In an experimental sense, it had been observed that electrons were ejected from metal surfaces that were exposed to light. This phenomenon is known as the photoelectric effect. Whether strong or weak light was projected onto metal, however, the energy of ejection of the resulting electron didn't change. I'll skip the physics mumbo-jumbo, but essentially it was expected that if light was a wave, then the electron's energy of ejection would be proportional to the strength of light. Einstein's explanation of light as a particle solved this quandary, and earned him the Nobel Prize in Physics.
Okay, this is getting ridiculous. I gotta show the audience this. So, we have cue cards with our lines on them to guide the episode, and my one now says, "Fascinating, but how does this explain the wonders of reflection and refraction?" Now, I may not be a geek. Hell, I don't even care about light, but I assure you that no one, I repeat, no one has ever or would ever say that.
Glad you asked, Crash.
God damn it.
To explore how light interacts with different mediums, it's usually easiest to think of it as a ray. Rays are simply thin beams of light that travel in a straight line. When I say reflection, most of you probably pictured a mirror, but all matter reflects light. Mirrors are special when compared to other types of matter because their surfaces are so smooth that any irregularities in the mirror surface are smaller than the wavelength of light. Other objects, such as rocks, for example, are too rough and exhibit diffuse reflection, whereby light being reflected is scattered so much as to not appear reflective to us.
What property determines how smooth the image in the mirror is? I'm not sure if it's my perfect haircut, my flawless skin, or my rippling abs.
If by rippling abs you mean undulating stomach, then sure, let's go with that. The basic law of reflection is that the angle of the ray reflected is equal to the angle of the ray incident upon a surface. By incident upon, I mean the ray of light which approaches and contacts or intersects with a surface. It's a bit like in pool. If you hit a ball against a wall, then it will leave the wall with the same angle. That's right, everyone. It's time for geometry.
I have to admit, geometry can be pretty useful. For example, what angle does this bullet have to enter Culture's head for him to stop talking about geometry?
I won't go into too much detail, I promise. Let's just start with a plane mirror, the type we use every day. A plane mirror is flat, and as such, there are a number of properties it carries. The image in the mirror is always upright, presented at the same distance from the mirror surface as you are, and is at a 1x magnification, so you appear normally sized.
Well, of course the image is upright. I'm not doing a handstand or something. Unless I'm trying to check out my obliques, of course.
Well, you see, not every reflected image is upright. Take a concave mirror, for example. The image appears inverted. To make sense of reflected images, scientists will often use ray diagrams. These diagrams project out the expected paths of rays of light based upon the law of reflection. Using these diagrams, one can determine, at least theoretically, the exact position and orientation of a reflected image. In the case of spherical mirrors, such as concave or convex mirrors, these diagrams become incredibly useful. If you have a spoon nearby, go take a look in the concave side of it.
The concave side is the one that curves away from you. The one that carries stuff. Like cereal or soup. Or crack cocaine.
Oh, okay. I appreciate the assist and all, but let's try to keep this PG, shall we?
Culture, we both know this show lost any chance of being PG when I was appointed as co-host.
Yeah, true. But back to the spoon example. If you look in the concave side of it, you'll notice that your image is inverted. But if you look in the other side, the convex side, then your image is displayed upright. Imagine yourself as a vertical line facing a large concave mirrored surface. If you draw a line from the top of your head straight along to the mirror, then the reflected light will bounce downwards due to the angle of the concave mirror. Now if you draw a line from your feet to the mirror, we get the opposite effect, and the image is bounced upwards. In this way, your head and your feet are flipped. Similar logic can be applied to a convex mirror to explain why your body appears stretched. In fact, with enough logic and patience, any distortion in a mirrored image can be explained.
Okay, enough. When I said I was interested in reflections, I really just meant my reflection, not all reflections. Can we move on?
Okay, fair enough. Let's talk about refraction instead. Refraction is the bending of light we observe when light travels from one medium into the other. The main example we'd be familiar with is the distortion of an image in water. This is due to the differing properties, for example, density, between the air and the water. When we talk about the speed of light, 3 by 10 to the 8 meters per second, this is actually a theoretical value, indicative of the speed of light in a vacuum. But when in a medium such as water, both the speed and wavelength of light are altered. Speed, wavelength, and frequency are connected by a simple formula where the speed is equal to the frequency times the wavelength.
Clearly, you and I are not on the same wavelength right now.
Hence, by using this formula, we see that the frequency doesn't change from one medium to the other, only the speed and the wavelength. Well, you see, the importance of this is that when light enters a different medium, it's also forced to change its path or trajectory as a result of the differing densities of the two mediums and subsequent speed change. SNELL'S law is used to describe the angle which light follows when changing mediums. But since Crash is already losing interest as it is, I won't get into the sines and thetas of the equation. You guys at home should definitely look into it, though.
Just tell me about colors already! I want to know why, when I trip balls, I can see so many colors!
Well, colors are essentially just different wavelengths of light. The electromagnetic spectrum is the full range of possible wavelengths of light, and contains many different types of rays. Higher wavelengths, or lower frequencies, include radio waves, microwaves, etc., whereas lower wavelengths or higher frequencies include gamma rays and X-rays. But between these two ends of the spectrum lies visible light. Visible light is pretty self-explanatory. It's the light our eyes are able to see and interpret. Colors occur at different wavelengths in this region of the spectrum, with red having the lowest frequency, nearing infrared rays, and violet having the highest frequency, nearing ultraviolet rays. White light contains all of these various frequencies, and by using a glass prism, as Isaac Newton did, we can split these frequencies up using the refractive properties of light discussed earlier.
Wait, so you're saying that every single color we see is actually just a tiny fraction of this whole spectrum? Wow! That's so... boring!
Yeah? Well, are rainbows boring? Rainbows show the full spectrum of colors, ranging from red to orange to yellow to green to blue to indigo, and finally to violet. Rainbows are formed when light refracts and disperses through raindrops. Imagine each raindrop is a tiny glass prism that separates light into its component colors. The result is a cone of colors, but the cone is cut off by the horizon. As a result, what we see is merely an arc of color. If we could see infrared and ultraviolet light, then the rainbow would also contain these forms of electromagnetic radiation. It also says on this site that the rainbow is a sign from God that he will never again flood the world to destroy all life. Huh.
Try telling that to the people who lost their homes in the Great Mississippi Flood of 1927. Truly, they are God-fearing people in the South.
So now we know what light is. How do we actually perceive and interpret color? Well...
hey, come on, this video is gonna go way too long. I have an appointment to get to. Let's finish this off another time.
Alright. Next time we'll cover some of the more biological and chemical aspects of sight, detailing the eye and the neural pathways involved in sight. See you guys next time.
Follow Culture Crash on social
media! So, Crash, what's this appointment about? I hope everything's alright.
Oh yeah, I'm fine. It's just my flexing appointment.
Flexing appointment?
Yeah. See? Like this. Ooh, yeah! Daddy like!
Ugh, gross.
Follow Culture Crash on social media! Like and subscribe for more!